Loving Heavenly Father, thank you for this wonderful evening, Lord. We have gathered here to meditate your word, Father. Help me to teach everything what's written in the word of God so that our eyes will be open to know you more and more, Lord. Bless everyone, those who are coming. Once again, I commit myself and all those who are attending in the name of Jesus, Father. Bless every one of them who have gathered here to listen to the word of God. Thank you once again. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I welcome you all in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Thank you once again. Nice meeting you all. As you know, we've been studying about the book of Revelation. We have come to part 31. Revelation 17th chapter, the first part we saw last week. And we were going to meditate about the seven heads and ten horns. Today we will see the rest of the 17th, the last, about the seven heads and ten horns, and also about 18th chapter, the commercial Babylon. As I told you last week, the 17th chapter is a religious Babylon or religious or spiritual Babylon. But chapter 18 is entirely about the political and commercial Babylon. Both the Babylons are going to be destroyed at the end. But it is believed that the Antichrist will destroy or dismantle the religious Babylon around the middle of the tribulation. And the commercial Babylon will be destroyed at the end of tribulation. That means the 17th chapter will happen, the destruction of 17th chapter of Babylon will be in the middle, and at the end will be 18th chapter commercial Babylon. I'll show you the screen now. And as I told you, this is about the seven heads and ten horns. We will look into detail what is meant by seven heads and ten horns. In Revelation, there are many women mentioned. There are mainly four women mentioned in Revelation. Because we saw the woman, the harlot, mother of the harlots in 17th chapter. So, since that woman is being taught, I just want to share with you about the women mentioned in Revelation. There are four people mentioned mainly. Jezebel, you see in the third chapter, and the woman clothed with the sun. Now, in 12th chapter of Revelation, harlot in 17th chapter, and his bride, 19th chapter. As you go further, I will explain. Here is the mind which has wisdom. The seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman sits. And they are seven kings. Out of the seven kings, five have fallen. One is, other one has not yet come. And when he comes, he must remain a little while. The beast which is and which is not is himself also an eighth, and is one of the seven, and goes to destruction. See, this is the picture we saw. The woman is seated on a beast which has seven heads and ten horns. And what are the seven heads? See, we saw here, you see, these are the seven empires which came one after another. First, the Egyptian Empire came, ruled by Pharaoh. Assyrian Empire came, ruled by Sennacherib. Then Babylonian Empire. The Assyrian Empire, Assyrian people were the one captured the southern tribe, the 10 tribes, Israel. And then Babylonian came, Nebuchadnezzar. During his period, he captured Judah, as prophesied by Isaiah and Jeremiah. Then Medes Persians came. King Cyrus. You know, about this Cyrus only God prophesies 150 years before he was born. He was a Gentile king, but God prophesies about him. He said, a Gentile king will come who will, by the name Cyrus, his name itself was mentioned, prophesied by God. Then Alexander the Great came. And during the time of Jesus, the Romans, the Caesars were ruling. The last kingdom is Antichrist. You see, the word says, they are seven kings. You saw the seven kings. One is, see the, during the time of John, the Roman Empire, the emperor is ruling. One is, that's what it means. The other has not yet come. That is Antichrist yet to come. You see, again, listen carefully. There were seven kings. Five have fallen. Pharaoh's fallen. Sennacherib. You know, Babylon fallen. Medes Persians fallen. Greek fallen. But during John's time, the Roman Empire is still there. And yet to come is Antichrist. He has to come. That's what it means. So the beast, which was, and which is not. You see, the beast which was, and which is not, is himself also an eighth and is one of the seven. See, during the tribulation period, Antichrist will come. Antichrist will come during the tribulation period. And during his tenure, somebody might kill him or he might have a wound where people will believe that he died. And then when he comes back to life, that is the one, the eighth one, which is not. Eighth one is one of the seven. That's what it means. Hope you understand. Out of seven, Antichrist will come. And eighth one will be the resurrected Antichrist. That's it. Simple. So these are the seven rulers. See, Egyptian king, Assyrian, Babylon, Medes Persians, Greek and Rome. And the seventh one is Antichrist. Yet to come. See, and the eighth one is from this. Out of this, that's what the picture I have put down. I wanted to show you all the empires. See, this is the Egyptian empire. It's really, you know, what is the beauty of Bible is, literally everything happened. This is the evidence which shows that the Bible is true, faithful and truthful. The word of God is faithful and truthful. All the kingdoms came one after another as prophesied by Daniel. You can find it in the book of Daniel. When Daniel interpreted the dream, he told everything consecutively. So all the kingdoms came, followed by Egyptian empire is the Assyrian empire. It was the worst empire, and they were the worst people who persecuted the Israelites. They're the worst people. They, wherever they go, they sprinkled salt all over the land to spoil their crops. These are the people from the Euphrates River, the Babylonian origin. And after Assyrian, you have the Babylonian Empire. Again, Nebuchadnezzar, this group captured the Jewish people. Three times they came and captured them. First group was Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, Daniel. Second group, they captured Ezekiel the prophet. third group was King Sadakaya. So this is also a tyrant empire. And this Babylonian empire is trying to revive. In future, this same empire will be resurrected again during the period of Antichrist. He might make it the same Babylonia, as a capital city, commercial city, as well as the political city. This is the empire going to be dismantled or destructed by the Antichrist. At the end, we'll see that. And the Persian Empire, you see the Babylonian Empire, I wanted to show you that Antichrist will destroy the religious Babylon, but God will use Antichrist to destroy it. And eventually the commercial Babylon, that is the 18th chapter Babylon, our Lord, when he comes, he will destroy everything. The commerce, the business will be destroyed. And you have Persian Empire. During this empire only, you have the story of Esther, Mordecai, all this stuff. And the king allowed Israelites to go back to Israel to build the temple wall, and the altar was repaired. Ezra, Nehemiah, all this group went during this tenure. And this is followed by the Greek Empire. It was the Alexander the Great. See, the Greek Empire is the area around Mediterranean Sea, the Asia Minor, you know, the African continent, and the Middle East, up to India. It was a vast land, vast area he covered, the Greek Empire. You see, in Galatians 4:5, it says that when the time fulfilled, I wanted to show you this verse because I want to share with you this. Galatians 4:5. You see, Galatians 4:4. When the fullness of the time came, God sent forth his son, you see, born of a woman, born under the law. When the fullness, now you listen carefully, when the fullness of time came, God sent forth his son. What is the fullness of time? This is the fullness of time. During this time, Jesus was born. Of course, after Romans came, but when the time became full? Because God was waiting for all the land to be covered with one language. See, when Jesus was born, Paul was able to take gospel all these areas up to Macedonia, Rome. You know, all these places, gospel spread very easily because of the Greek ruling, because of the Alexander, he made everywhere, the Greek language was spread everywhere. So the media was Greek language. Moreover, Romans built, Alexander the Great also built the road. And followed by the Romans, they too built the roads to go everywhere. So the transportation facility was very easy. The gospel was taken easily. Lydia from London, UK, it's believed that she's an European woman. She heard gospel from Paul. She took the gospel. So when the time came, Jesus was born. God was waiting for the time. So gospel was taken to many continents very easily. That's the reason the Greek Empire. And the Greek Empire is followed by the Romans. You see, further expansion. Paul was taking all over the world. Gospel went everywhere. These are the seven empires. Daniel saw a statue. You see the gold, silver, bronze, iron and clay. This literally happened. I wanted to explain. These are the evidence that the word of God is truthful. See here. Say Daniel 2nd chapter, you will see it. Then what happened? You see, Daniel, from this side, he saw all the empires when he saw it. But when John, from Patmos, he saw the other way, reverse around. Rome, Greek, Medes, Persians. We learned in the 13th chapter of Revelation. You see, all these empires literally came into existence. And you see in the Daniel statue, said 2, verse 44, Daniel 2, 44. In the days of this, final 10, the kings, the word of the God of heaven will set up a kingdom that will never be destroyed, nor its sovereignty will be left for another people. You see, the big stone is going to crush the statue, all the empires. It's going to put an end to all these kingdoms and it will stand forever. All these seven empires will be destroyed because, you see here, a stone cut out of the mountain without hands will come and demolish all the empires. Daniel 2, 34, 35 and 44. This kingdom is going to be, when Jesus comes, this is the kingdom which is going to be established forever. This is a kingdom which will stand forever. So the 10 horns, what happens again? The 10 horns are the 10 nations, which is so are the 10 kings. And they have not received the kingdom, but they will receive authority as kings of the beast for 1 hour. They give their power and authority to the beast, and these will wage war against the Lamb, and the Lamb will overcome them. You see in the 16th chapter, the kings of the earth will come through river, dried Euphrates River, to wage war against the Lamb. And he said to me, the waters which you saw where the harlot sit are the people, multitude, nation and language or tongues. And see here, I put it in a short form. The 10 kings give their power and authority to the beast. We saw about the 7 heads and now we are looking at the 10 horns. 10 horns and 7 horns and 10 horns. So the 10 horns are the 10 kings. They give power and authority to the beast. And they will wage war against the Lamb, and the Lamb will overcome them. So the last difficult days is going to come. There will be lover of money. They will be boastful, arrogant, revilers, disobedient to parents. These are all going to happen during those times. Ungrateful, unholy. You know, the mother of harlots. We are talking about the mother of harlots who is seated on the beast. All evil habits will be prevailing everywhere. Men will be lovers of self during those times. Unloving, irreconcilable, malicious gossips, without self-control, brutal, haters of good, treacherous, reckless, conceited, lovers of pleasure, rather than lovers of God, holding to a form of godliness, although they have denied its power. They will not have. You see, go for the 2 Peter 2, 1 to 3. I have brought in the bullet points. During those times, there will be false prophets among the people. They will persuade people to worship the Antichrist. They say that he is God. In the middle of the tribulation period, he will sit in the temple and claim himself to be God. False teachers will be there. Even today, you find these kind of people, false prophets, false teachers. They will secretly introduce destructive heresies. It's being done there today. They will bring swift destruction upon themselves. Many will follow their sensuality. And because of them, the way of the truth will be malign. They will exploit you with false words. They will teach you very false doctrine. The world, World Church Council, they will bring all the religion together, ungodly union. It will be spearheaded by the Council of Churches. Latter-day ungodly union. They bring people from different religion under the umbrella of one religion, where false teachers, false preachers, false prophets, false doctrine, people will be made to believe on this nonsense. So what happened at the end? This ungodly union, the church council will try to control Antichrist. The religious system was brought by Antichrist. Now when they are becoming popular, they will try to control Antichrist. Then the end of the prostitute, the religious system will come. I told you the woman is none other than the religious system. You will have many religions coming together under one umbrella. There will be a big spiritual leader equal to Antichrist. And the same person will try to control Antichrist. Then the problem will start. Why? If you see the history, same thing happened in history before. You see, the 10 horns which you saw and the beast, they will hate the harlot. You see, the 10 horns, the kings of the world who were supporting the Antichrist, they will start hating the harlot, the spiritual leader, and will make her desolate and naked, and will eat her flesh and will burn her up with fire. The religious system eventually will be dismantled and destroyed by Antichrist. That will be the end of the woman. That too, God will bring to an end. It's by God as well as. You see here, for God has put it in their hearts to execute his purpose by having a common purpose. And by giving their kingdom to the beast until the words of God would be fulfilled. The woman whom you saw is the great city which reigns over the kings of the earth. See, the problem will start when church tries to control Antichrist. There are many examples in history, I told you, trying to control kings, rulers, even the true preachers. You see here history, this is an example. Pope Gregory the VII in the 11th century, he made a verdict. He said like this: it is laid down that the Roman pontiff is universal bishop, that his name is the only one of its kind in the world. You see, the pontiff, the bishops, by trying to control the church, He says that the pontiff, I am, Gregory says, I am the universal bishop. It's a big verdict. To him alone, it belongs to dispose or reconcile bishops. He can terminate anyone. He can reinstate anyone. He alone may use the ensigns of empire. And you see, finally, the blue words I have written here, all princes, who the rulers, the emperors, are bound to kiss his feet, he has the right to depose emperors. The Pope of all, above all judgment. You read the many martyrs, reformers. Lately, I saw about John Huss. The Roman, same Roman, the bishops called him and said, you should not preach Bible. You are evil. You are Satan. See, the righteous will live by faith. But they were following strictly their books, Catholic doctrines, sainthood, praying through beads, praying to dead people, purgatory, indulgences, so many things are there. The main church was taken over by them until the Protestant Luther came. During their reign, during the bishop's reign, so many Christians were burned at stake. John Huss was burned at stake just because he was preaching the word, true word of God. They told him, you should not preach, say that, deny Jesus. You are a evil. They were also behaving as if they are true Christians. They didn't want people to listen to the word of God. They were mending money from people. They were cheating people. So gradually, the bishops, they tried to control the Church of England. Bishop Henry, then you have King James. You got the James version after that. There was a lady called Bloody Mary, King Henry's sister. She was the worst of all. She killed many Christians. Many of them were burned to death. They tried to control the government. Same thing will happen later days. During the period of tribulation, the church council will try to control when they intervene with the Antichrist. Then he will destroy this religious system with the help of 10 nations. These are all the prophecies word and is going to happen very soon. We saw about how the religions are coming together, ecumenical ones. So God will destroy the harlot through Antichrist. God will destroy the harlot. You see here? These will hate the harlot and make desolate. We've seen already. That's it. Now we'll enter into the 18th chapter. Revelation 18. This is a commercial Babylon. The difference between commercial and religious Babylon is this is purely business. A big city, big cities will be built. Once again, I wanted to show you about the Babylon, how it came into history. It's about the political and commercial city. History and fall of Babylon, you know about this. Tower of Babel. The Lamb of God will destroy the religious and commercial system at the end of the world. See, when he comes in his second coming, all will be destroyed. Babel, you should know about it. Babel, the original derivation of the name Babel is very much uncertain, but however, in Akkadian name, the name of the city was Babilim, meaning gate of God. So according to the Bible, the city received the name Babel. Babel meaning to jumble or to confuse. This is the word. Confusion. Babel. This is a Hebrew word, Babel. You see? Height 894. One day I'll show you how to look into the Bible. Like how to see the Hebrew word. H894. If you type the number, you get, I will show you now. H894. See here? This is a study, not preaching once again. I want to show you. Hebrew, where is it? H894. It is getting slow. Anyhow. Okay. You see here? H894, Babel. This is confusion. Including Babylonia, Babylonian Empire. This is how we need to do the Bible study. You know, when you read Bible, some Bibles will have all the words in, you see, if you take this Bible, see here, you see the number. When you read the New Testament, you will have Greek, G. You see here, go near. If you go to the Old Testament, say for example, Genesis 1:1, or any chapter, Habakkuk 1:1, it will be in H, Hebrew. You see here, Lord. You go here, Lord, Yehovah. You see here, this is how you need to do the Bible study, word study. Every word you can look into this. It's a beautiful app. So you can learn Hebrew, what is Greek in the New Testament. So this will help you to do in-depth study. So here you have Babel means the place of confusion. See here, confusion by mixing. This is the ancient Babylonian tablet. It is still there. These pictures are there. Provides compelling evidence. There are evidences. And in 11th chapter, we see, come, let us build ourselves a city. Tower of Babel. They wanted to go all the way up. And the Lord came down to see the city. And they wanted to make themselves a name for them. So God came down and confused their language. You know about it. And so they will not understand each other. And God dispersed them. So then, you see, yes, therefore its name was called Babel. Because the Lord confused the language of the whole earth. You will find Babel towers all over the world. You know, it reminds us of the Babel tower. Even today, you find the towers all over the world. People wanted to go all the way up, higher. The reason why God dispersed them, they wanted to make themselves name. Even today, the countries wanted to show their power. You see here, this is a Taiwan Babel Tower. There are towers. Even in India, the multimillionaire has built a big, going up the house, Ambani, I think. See, it is there. The Tower of Babel at the city of China, Dalian. It is there. Europe's Tower, Babel, Financial Times. This is also there. See, it's a reminiscent of all the Babel Tower. It's all original. Origin is from there only. All over the world you will find the towers built. In different generation. Not only today, now. Right from the beginning, people, even the old history, geology, you find all the, in Mexico also you find these towers. Old ones. See, Burj Khalifa. See, in New York Tower of Babel. See, there are, okay. So this commercial city, you can, you know, it's a simple explanation I have given from the end of the 23-24 verses. You find all these details about this commercial city, Babylon. It's a very rich city. This Babylon, you know, this city will be rebuilt by Antichrist. There will be a lot of big buildings, lightings, casinos, theaters, everything. It will be a huge city, bigger than New York City. The Babylon old empire will be resurrected, you can say. Antichrist will make that place as the headquarters. People from all over the world flock in there to make business. See, whenever a business is opened anywhere in the world, see why people are flocking into Dubai. China has come to Dubai because they have opened business. They said, come and do business with us. Same way, Antichrist will open the commercial city for the entire world to come and do business with him in that city. And people will become very rich. They will forget God. And God is going to take revenge on this city. That's what the 18th chapter is about. See, so then you can hear the sound of harpists, musicians, flute players, trumpeters. You go to London, you will find the same sounds everywhere. London city or any city, you walk around in the heart of the city, you hear music, sounds, dancing, cinema theaters, pubs. You find what is not available in the world, you can find everywhere. Food courts, works of craftsmen, sound of mill herd, city with lights, casinos, bustling activities. All these are found there. You see, this is a city of lights. I have just given an example. Now, existing city. This, the coming city will be more bigger than this. You see? Will not shine in you any longer, he says. And the light of the lamp will not shine in you any longer. And the voice of the bridegroom and bride will not be heard in you any longer. When God destroys this, this is what happens now. No more lights, no more bridegroom, no more marriages. You see, now pandemic period came. Many things were cancelled. All the wedding halls booked were cancelled. Many weddings were cancelled during corona time. Public gatherings were cancelled. But when God takes revenge on these cities, when he destroys, everything will be gone. People will be losing everything. The light will not shine. See, 22, 24, this is what I mentioned. The sound of harpists and musicians, the flute players, trumpeters will not be heard in you any longer. The cities will be like this. This is simple only. This is the present day city. The future commercial city established by Antichrist will be very huge and bigger, attract the whole world, people from the world. You see, they will make business of all this. Gold, silver, stone, pearl, you know, linen, silk, purple, wood, ivory, costly wood, iron, marble, you know, nearly 25. These are all luxury items, not necessities. The luxury items will be sold everywhere. Perfumes, frankincense, olive oil, wheat, cattle, sheep, cargoes, horses, chariots, human lives, slave market. Even today, people are being sold. You find in the major cities, you find people are being kidnapped, sold, children are missing, women are kidnapped for prostitution. You see, and during that, you know, this literally happened in US slave market. The slaves are made to stand in public, put on auction. People bought, paid money. You see that? It had literally happened in America. Same thing will happen during the period of Antichrist. The people from the upper society, higher level, will control the one who are poor also. So the city I have description I have given here. Hotbed of demons and false doctrine. They will make people believe the false teaching. It would be the capital of godless and materialism, filled with both iniquity and arrogance. It will be the worst city in the world. Center of drug activities and bloodshedding. Mainly the saints, the holy ones, will be executed. And who will destroy it? The source of the destruction is God. He will destroy the city. In the 18th chapter, you will find it how, verse 9, 10 is explained. How will he destroy it? And what happens when he destroys the city? Despair on earth. The people of the people will be standing far away and crying for the city. It will be very severe. But at the same time, there is happiness in heaven. See, in this 18th, this is only the introduction about the 18th chapter. In the 18th chapter, there are three angels proclaiming the fall of Babylon. It says, the first angel will come and say, Babylon is fallen. Second angel will come and say the reason for falling. Third angel will say how it happens. See here. The three angels proclaim the fall of Babylon. If we take 1 to 3 verses, lament over Babylon. 4 to 20, how to escape, come out of Babylon. You know, the Christians are being warned to come out of, those who are left behind are being warned to come out. There are three woes mentioned there. And the doom of the Babylon, the finality of Babylon's doom is mentioned there. So the first three verses, lament over fallen Babylon. See here, first verse. After these things, I saw another angel coming down from heaven, having great authority, and the earth was illumined with his glory. When angel is coming down, the earth is illumined with the glory of the angel, and he is crying. You know, it's a bustling city. It is a city filled with all filth. And the angel comes and says, fallen, fallen is Babylon the Great. She has become the dwelling place of demons and the prison of every unclean spirit and the prison of every unclean and hateful bird. There are many cities in the world like this. When there is no God, certainly even the houses will become a place of demons. If there is no God in your house, if there is no God in your heart, if you are not filled with the Spirit of God, demons will come and reside in your heart. Mind it. It's a prison of every unclean spirit. You know, you read when the heart is cleaned, when evil spirit goes away, you need to fill your heart with the Holy Spirit. If not, the spirit which went out to the wilderness will come back with more powerful spirit, evil spirit, and reside in your heart. And your later day will be worse than the former days. Not only in the cities, in your heart, in your house, become a dwelling place of demons. You will find in the face, dark face. And prison of every unclean spirit, hateful bird, is telling about it. Why? For all the nations have drunk of the wine of the passion of her immorality. You see, when a person is demon possessed, he will infect others. He will invite his friends also to take part in his evil activities. And the kings of the earth have committed acts of immorality with her, with this commercial system. And the merchants of the earth have become rich by the wealth of her sensuality. You see, God is bringing a doomsday to this nation, to this empire. The first angel proclaimed, the second angel now, warning to escape Babylon's judgment. There are three woes mentioned in this. From verses 4 to 20, there are three woes. 18:10, it says that, woe to you, great city, you mighty city of Babylon, in 1 hour, your doom has come. It doesn't take very long. It won't take very long. You know, the tower in America, September 11th, it did not take very long to destroy such a huge building. Woe to you, great city, the mighty city of Babylon, in 1 hour your doom has come. And 16 verse, woe to you again, great city, dressed in fine linen, purple, scarlet. Woe to you. You may be dressed, you may be a great city. And woe to you, great city, and people made business with you. Now you see here, 4 to 6, come out of her. He says that, come out of her, my people, so that you will not participate in her sins and receive the plagues. For sins have piled up as high as heaven. God remembered her iniquities. You know, when evil happens, either in a house or in a society or in a nation, it will reach God. Even when you cry, when the Israelites were crying in Egypt because of the whip masters, the whip masters were beating the Egyptians and the Israelites. The Israelites cried, that sound reached heaven. God came down. Sodom, Gomorrah, evil reached, evil sound. Their sins reached heaven. God sent the angels to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. When you pile up your sin, certainly God will take action against you, whoever it may be. Don't play with God. Let the Spirit of God reside in your heart. If you do not have Holy Spirit, certainly the evil spirit, the demons will occupy your heart. And the sins will pile up like a tower. And God can hear the voice. He can hear the voice of the blood. He can hear the noise of sin. He can hear the cry of his people. Everything reaches heaven. I just want to remind you, come out of her. He is calling people to come out of that, because God will take revenge on them. Do not participate in their sins and receive of their plagues. If you keep doing, when God takes revenges, when the doomsday comes, you will also be affected. That's what he says. He saw already it's a dwelling place, every all kind of evil. She told herself as a, I sit as a queen and I am not a widow and will never see mourning. That's what she was telling. Nearly 25 expensive items are mentioned here. These are all the sins of Babylon found in the chapter 18. You see, earlier see in Numbers, move back from the tents of this wicked man, Korah. God, before he is destroying people, he will always warn people to come out. See, when Sodom and Gomorrah was to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah, what did he do? He sent two angels there to redeem some people. Many refused. Only Lot and his family were redeemed from there. He says here, move back from the tents of this wicked man. Do not touch anything belonging to them, or you will be swept away because of their sins. So they moved away from the tents of Korah, Dathan and Abiram. And they were standing with their family and children, little ones at the entrance of their tents. What happened? As soon as he finished saying all this, the ground split open and the earth opened its mouth and swallowed them. Who? Korah, Dathan and Abiram. God told others to come out of that families. He said, I'm going to punish them. Now God expects you and me. God wants to redeem us before the cruel day starts. Before the day of trouble starts. Before the end time event starts. Before the Jacob trouble starts. God wants to redeem us. He wants to rapture us. Same way, he wants people to come out of Babylon. During those time, I'm telling, this will happen when come out of her, the 144,000 preaching there. And 11th chapter, two witnesses are preaching there. What do they say? Come out of Babylon. It's going to be destroyed. Come out. But now, God is warning you and me. Be ready. Come out of the world. Do not have hand with the world. Be separated as I am separated. Be holy as I am holy. God wants people to come out of the world. Come unto me. God expects us to be ready before the tribulation starts. He will snatch us up to heaven. Then the tribulation will start. Before the land being split, he told the people to come away from the tent of Korah. See, in Genesis, you see here Genesis. We are about to destroy the place because their outcry has become so great before the Lord. It's about Sodom and Gomorrah. There the two men said to Lot, whom else you have here? Your son-in-law and your sons and your daughters and whomever you have in the city, bring them out of the place. Because the cry has heard by God and he is going to destroy. So he brought them out. Lot, his wife and two daughters. The sons-in-law refused to go along with them. Of course, on the way, Lot's wife become a salty stone statue. God wants to rescue us from the world. We are living in the world, but do not mingle with the world. Do not mingle with the evil activities. Be filled with the Holy Spirit. He says that go forth from Babylon in Isaiah. Flee from Chaldeans. You see, many prophetic verses are there. To the degree, it's about again commercial Babylon. she glorified herself and lived sensuously to the same degree, give her torment and mourning. Come out of her. I am going to give her torment. She says in her heart, I sit as a queen and I am not a widow and I will never see mourning. People will follow that. God said in 18:8 then, for this reason one day her plagues will come, pestilence and mourning and famine, and she will be burned up with fire. For the Lord God who judges her is strong. And the kings of the earth who committed acts of immorality, they will weep and lament over her when they see the smoke of her burning. See, these are the, I told you about the verse, I don't know. You see, what happened in America? I'm not saying that this is America. Some preachers are preaching that this commercial Babylon is America. No. We don't know. I don't want to blame, say America. But I'm giving you the example. September 11, the tower fell down. People standing at a distance because of the fear of the torment saying, "Woe, woe to the great city Babylon, the strong city. In 1 hour, judgment has come." See, fallen, the Babylon the Great, the mother of horrors and of the abominations. I want to show you some pictures faster. See, commercial Babylon. Anyway, we'll see next week. You read Ezekiel 26 and 27, you find all the luxury items mentioned here. So we'll see how the commercial is being done in this city. We'll see in detail. God wants to warn us. God wants to separate us from this world. We are not going to witness this. We are the children of God. Always remember this. Come out. Do not have any part in this. We are called to be holy. Let's pray. Father God, I thank you that whatever you revealed me, Father, I have given your word to thy people, Father. Whoever is listening, Father, let them open their heart to receive you as their personal Savior and Lord. Guide them. It is not a place where the demons should dwell, Father. Their heart is for the Holy Spirit, Father. Fill them with the Holy Spirit for the day of redemption. No more unclean spirits. No more demons. Demon possession. And no more part in the commercial Babylon, Lord. Make us holy as you are holy. I bless everyone who have been listening to this study and those who are listening through the YouTube, Father. I bless everyone in the name of Jesus. May God bless them, Father. Anoint them every single day. Thank you once again for this lovely time. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you all. Thank you.
Thank you, Pastor.
Thank you, Pastor.